establishing the innermost desires of Srila Prabhupada. His firm faith in Srimad Bhagavatam. Guru Maharaj used to preach in Tejpur, Assam. During one of his visits there, a gentleman named Shri Sudhir Bakshi would daily attend Guru Maharaj's Harikatha at the Bengali theatre. Shri Sudhir Bakshi was the first person to request Guru Maharaj to accept a separate seat on the dais. He told Guru Maharaj, "Previously, you would share a sitting place with your godbrothers, but now you are performing the role of an acharya and have accepted many disciples. Please mercifully accept a separate sitting place." On his request, Guru Maharaj accepted a separate sitting place for the first time. One day, Shri Sudhir Bakshi approached Guru Maharaj and said, "My mother has been unwell for quite some time. She is bedridden and has not eaten or drunk anything for many days. Her medical tests were unable to report any sickness. Sometimes, when we offer her Charnamrit or Ganga water, she opens her mouth and accepts it. In order to deliver her from this painful situation, I have donated cows, carried out Chandrayan Vrata, footnote, an austerity in which the amount of food one consumes is gradually reduced to zero and then increased to normal according to the lunar cycle, and also arranged for the recitation of Srimad Bhagavatam, but with no effect. I feel greatly distressed upon seeing her pitiful condition. I am unable to understand my duty during this stage of her life. I would be grateful if you could kindly advise us as to how she can be delivered." Guru Maharaj told him, "If a person hears Srimad Bhagavatam from the lips of a non-devotee, a Vaishnava, from one who charges a fee for his recitation, Bhrittaka Pathaka, or from someone who makes his living reciting it, Bhagavat Jivi, then not only will his existing auspiciousness be destroyed, but it is likely he will attract even more inauspiciousness. Therefore, you should hear Bhagavatam only from a devotee of the Lord, whose very life is Bhagavatam, and who is the well-wisher of the entire world. Only then can one achieve one's true topmost welfare." Shri Sudhir Bakshi then said, "In that case, you alone must speak Srimad Bhagavatam to my mother. Where else will I find a person with the characteristics you have described?" Guru Maharaj replied, "I am already engaged in speaking 3 times a day here, and so it will not be possible for me to accept any other engagements at this time." Shri Sudhir Bakshi then requested Guru Maharaj to arrange for a similarly qualified person to recite Srimad Bhagavatam. Guru Maharaj told him, "I will send my godbrother Shri Krishna Kesha Prabhu in my stead. You can arrange for him to be taken to your place tomorrow." The following day, Shri Sudhir Bakshi sent his car at the agreed upon time. I was with Guru Maharaj transcribing his dictation when news came of the car's arrival. Guru Maharaj asked me to call Shri Krishna Kesha Prabhu. I went to look for him, but found that he had already left for another program. I conveyed this message to Guru Maharaj, who then ordered me to go to Shri Sudhir Bakshi's home along with another 3 or 4 devotees and take with us kartals, kansa, mridanga and the charnamrit of Shri Thakurji. I wondered what would happen if Shri Sudhir Bakshi's mother were not to attain deliverance upon hearing my recitation of Bhagavatam. Despite this concern, I followed Guru Maharaj's order. When I arrived, I put Charnamrit into that Mataji's mouth and then asked the family to arrange my seat in such a position that she could properly hear the recitation of Bhagavatam. We performed Shri Bhagavat Katha and Kirtan at their place and then returned. I was greatly astonished to hear that Shri Sudhir Bakshi's mother departed from this world the very next day. Upon observing Guru Maharaj's firm faith in Srimad Bhagavatam, a scripture that Srimad Mahaprabhu has described as the supremely flawless evidence for establishing the absolute truth, as well as his transcendental influence as displayed through his incident. My faith and conviction in his most divine personality increase exponentially. Always mindful of the Master's comfort. Once during Sri Brajmandal Parikrama, Guru Maharaj, Sri Srimad Bhakti Pramod Puri Goswami Maharaj, Sri Srimad Bhakti Vilas Bharti Goswami Maharaj, Sri Srimad Bhakti Vikash Rishikesh Goswami Maharaj, and I, their servant, were traveling from Sri Sanket Bihari to Nandgram by car. On the way, our car ran out of petrol and stopped. I arranged for a tanga, horse cart, by which Guru Maharaj and others could continue on to the Dharamshala, guest house. Before departing, Guru Maharaj tossed me his money bag, which I nimbly caught. Later, as I was giving money to the driver to fetch petrol, I saw the key to Guru Maharaj's room in the money bag. I asked the driver, "Will you pass through Nandgram on your way to get petrol?" The driver replied, "Definitely. The only bus route is via Nandgram." I gave him Guru Maharaj's room key and said, "Since I have to wait here with the car, you should first go to the Dharamshala and give this key to Shripad Din Bandhu Das Babaji Maharaj, a disciple of Srila Prabhupada, before fetching petrol." Heeding my words, the driver eventually arrived at the Dharamshala and gave the keys to Sri Babaji Maharaj quite some time before Guru Maharaj's arrival. When Guru Maharaj reached the Dharamshala, the devotees who had come along with him went to their respective rooms. But when Guru Maharaj realized that his room key was in the money bag he had given me, he began to pace around without mentioning the situation to anyone so that no one would be inconvenienced. Sri Dinbandhu Das Babaji Maharaj approached Guru Maharaj and said, "Maharaj, please take rest in your room." Guru Maharaj said, "Guru Bhai, dear God brother, I made a great blunder today. I left my room key with Bharti Maharaj." Srila Babaji Maharaj said, "Maharaj, Bharti Maharaj has sent the room key through the driver, and it reached me even before your arrival." Guru Maharaj then went to his room and rested. Guru Maharaj mentioned the incident during Harikatha that evening and also explained the symptoms of an Uttam Sevak, advanced topmost servant, and an Adham Sevak, unqualified servant. While describing the idol serving tendency, Chitta Vritti, a servant should possess, he said, "An Uttam Sevak is always conscious of all the services at hand, and he is expert in assessing which services he should attend to and at what time he should attend to them. Although the master, that is, the object of service, may not be mindful of his belongings, like his keys, the Uttam Sevak gives great attention to such items and eagerly endeavors wholeheartedly to make sure his master is not inconvenienced. Such a sevak is highly satisfied to please his master and does not mind enduring physical or mental trouble to this end. Bhagwan sees the endeavor of a sincere sevak and provides him with all the required intelligence to properly perform service." That day, I felt highly bashful when many devotees conveyed to me the affection and satisfaction Guru Maharaj possessed for me as a result of the service I performed. The following words of Srila Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami repeatedly drifted in my mind like waves on a shore. "Alpa seva bahu mane atma paryanta prasad." Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita Antya Lila 1.107. The Lord considers as great whatever little service one offers, and He mercifully offers Himself to that person in return. His faith in my ability to serve Him. Whenever I would leave from Sridhar Mayapur to visit our Kolkata Mart, I would always joyously collect large quantities of ghee, paneer, bananas, cabbage, and other items from the dham and bring them to Guru Maharaj, who always said that seeing, touching, honoring, and distributing anything from the dham leads to the most sublime transcendental pleasure. Guru Maharaj would assign great significance to every item I had brought, and while distributing them among the devotees, he would specifically tell them, "Today you are receiving this item from the Dham as prasad. You are greatly fortunate to have met with this opportunity to taste and honor an item produced in the Dham. Bhagwan has been merciful to you, for he has sent someone to bring this item to you as a token of his mercy." Once, I had gone to visit Guru Maharaj in his bhajan kutir in our Kolkata mutt after returning from Mayapur. But when I entered his room, I came to know he was taking bath at the time. His personal assistant, Shri Madan Gopal Prabhu, was also not there in the room. I have brought some paneer for Guru Maharaj, but since neither he nor his assistant were available, I left it with the bhandari and immediately went outside to acquire a permit for purchasing cement and drop off some letters I had seen in Guru Maharaj's room at the post office. When Guru Maharaj returned to his room after bathing, he noticed the letters on his table were missing and asked Shri Madan Gopal Prabhu, "Did Bharti Maharaj come here?" Since Madan Gopal Prabhu was not in Guru Maharaj's room while I was there, he replied, "I did not see him." Later, when Guru Maharaj saw me after lunch prasad, he asked me about everything and said, "I was initially a bit worried that the letters had been misplaced because I had written them with great care and attention. Then my worry increased when Madan Gopal said that he had not seen you. But now that I have learned you posted the letters, I wanted to say one thing. Although I have many disciples who readily do whatever I tell them, none are like you, who are able to use his intelligence to understand which services should be performed without having to be told. I wish that I could be so fortunate as to have just one or two people like you with me at all times, so I could incessantly preach the message of Sriman Mahaprabhu to a greater capacity." A deep love for Bhagwan's Dham. Whether during Sri Brajmandal Parikrama, Sri Navdeep Dham Parikrama, Sri Kshetra Mandal Parikrama, a North Indian tour or a South Indian tour, Guru Maharaj never paid any mind to the cleanliness of the ground while offering his prostrated obeisances. Dandvat Pranam. Once, Guru Maharaj offered Dandvat Pranam at Vishram Ghat, even though it was very muddy. At that time, Sri Revati Ranjan Chaudhary quickly called for his wife. "Come, come," he shouted. "Look, this is the only sight worth seeing. Although Sri Madhav Maharaj has such a beautiful face and features and is wearing spotlessly clean clothes, he is offering Dandvat Pranams in a very muddy area. He has truly realized the transcendental glories of the Dham. Such conduct and affection for the Lord's pastime place is our one and only goal." Tolerating cruelty. One day, when the construction of our Kolkata branch of Sri Chaitanya Gaudiya Math was almost complete, Guru Maharaj told me, "I want to view the dome of our mutt from a distance to see how it looks from far away." I replied, "Certainly, just tell me from which direction and at what distance you would like to see it, and I will take you." Guru Maharaj then got up and we headed out of the mud. After walking for some distance, we stood at the corner and intersection and observed the dome. At that time, a group of boys passed by. Upon seeing Guru Maharaj's tallness, his glowing crimson complexion, and his divinely attractive features, as well as my tall and stout physical appearance, they commented, "Just see, these people are thriving on the donations of others." Guru Maharaj and I both heard their comments. To prevent me from retorting, Guru Maharaj said, "We should not think of those who mock us as adversaries, nor should we react to their insults. Those who accept the dress of a sadhu ought to follow the example of Sri Nityanand Prabhu, who performed kirtan and distributed the wealth of transcendental prem even after Madai had struck him in the forehead with an earthen pot. They should learn to not only tolerate the brutality of antagonists, but also wish for their welfare. Just like Srila Prabhupada, who remained unprovoked even after being attacked at Prodomaya during Sri Navadvip Parikrama. They should tolerate not only cruelty, but also the insults hurled at them, which pierce much deeper than the sharpest edged weapons. Hardly commenting further, the boys passed ahead of us. After that, the situation was over, and I realized the futility of reacting to such trivial insults. Accepting nothing for himself. Once, Guru Maharaj preached in Amritsar, accompanied by 20 devotees, including Sri Bhakti Vallabh Tirth Maharaj, Sri Bhakti Prasad Puri Maharaj, Sri Ghanashyam Brahmachari, myself, and number of our godbrothers. Lala Sri Vishan Das, who was the greatest contributor to the construction of the Sri Durgyana Mandir in Amritsar, had arranged for our accommodation, prasad, and whatever else Guru Maharaj and his party required. He introduced us to a milk vendor and said, he will provide whatever milk you may require in both the morning and evening. He then introduced us to a grocer and said, whatever you may need, be it rice, pulses, flour, ghee, or anything else, please do not hesitate to ask him. He will provide you with whatever you need. Guru Maharaj later told us in private, we are bhikshus, mendicants. We should never ask for or accept anything for our own use. In fact, we are sadhus or persons who are fully dependent upon Satvastu, Shri Bhagwan, and follow the principle of Yatichhe Lava Santosh, being completely satisfied with whatever comes of its own accord by the desire of Shri Bhagwan. Additionally, Tat Kripavalokanam, sadhu sees his mercy in every situation, and therefore, a preaching sadhu should never ask for anything for himself. Above all, a sadhu preacher should not stay in the home of a grastha. However, if he is circumstantially compelled to stay in the home of a grastha, he should do so in a most disciplined manner and strictly maintain the Vaishnava etiquette befitting a renunciate. He should remain satisfied with whatever the grastha devotee provides according to his capacity and of his own sweet will. If out of extreme necessity, the preaching sadhu should require anything beyond what his grastha host is capable of providing, he should request money from the bhandari or ashrami. Footnote: a person who collects and stores all the ingredients necessary for serving Shri Bhagwan and his devotees, and also manages the affair of a math or ashram of the math before departing on his journey, and purchase whatever is needed with that money. He should remain fervently careful that others do not find his activities to be objectionable or disgraceful. Therefore, ask neither the milk vendor nor the grocer for anything. All that we need will become available by the mercy of Sri Guru, Vaishnavas and Bhagwan. If any of you need anything additional, then you can ask me for the money to purchase it. Although our host has told us to ask for whatever we desire, still, I will feel great shame if anyone accepts anything for his own use. Following Guru Maharaj's order, none of us asked for anything from either the milk vendor or the grocer. But when the milk vendor became increasingly insistent, we agreed to daily accept 5 liters of milk. Lala Sri Vishan Das, however, instructed the milk vendor to forcefully give us 20 liters. When Guru Maharaj came to know we were accepting 20 liters of milk a day, he chastised us. When we informed Guru Maharaj that we asked for nothing, but rather Lala Vishan Das instructed the milk vendor to give us 20 liters of milk, Guru Maharaj said, okay, fine, cook here daily with the milk and I will offer it to Thakurji. Every evening, we will distribute that kheer to the audience after Harikatha. We prepared kheer daily and Guru Maharaj happily distributed the prasad to the audience every night. After the Amritsar program had concluded and we continued on to another program at a different location. Lala Shri Vishan Das told others, "The devotees stayed at my place here for 15 days, but I did not incur any cost. First of all, they did not want to take anything. Then, even when I offered, they would not accept anything. When finally, I forcefully gave them something, they distributed it to everyone. They are truly uninterested in accepting anything for themselves, whether for immediate or later use. Many other visiting sadhus often ask for us to provide them with supplies for their journey. But Shri Madhav Maharaj and his traveling sadhus were uninterested in accepting supplies for themselves even while they were staying here. What then can be said of their interest in collecting things to take with them?" When Guru Maharaj manifested his disappearance pastime, Lala Shri Vishan Das published an article in a local Amritsar newspaper informing all about Guru Maharaj's physical disappearance from this world. He wrote, "Throughout my lifetime, I have received darshan of many sadhus who have visited Amritsar to speak Harikatha and perform Kirtan. But despite their best efforts, none of them could hide their faults from my astute perceptiveness. Shri Bhakti Dait Madhav Goswami Maharaj was the only great soul who exhibited an absolutely spotless character during his visit in Amritsar. He was, in the true sense, a sadhu. What to speak of me? Even the most wicked of persons would be unable to detect any fault in his divine character." Shri Murari Lal Vasudev of Punjab National Bank used to accompany Lala Shri Vishan Das to hear Guru Maharaj's Harikatha and Kirtan. He, along with his four sons, had personally served Guru Maharaj and observed his conduct very closely. After Guru Maharaj entered a Prakat Leela, Shri Raghunath Das, one of his sons of Shri Murari Lal Vasudev, moved to Mumbai. There, he invited some preaching devotees to visit his home for some days. As soon as the devotees entered his house, a few of them demanded a few items, including 2 dozen bars of Dove brand soap. Shri Raghunath Das then phoned my godbrother Shri Bhakti Prasad Puri Maharaj and asked, "Maharaji, please confirm whether or not this preacher have been sent by Shri Chaitanya Gaudiya Math. Perhaps they are independently traveling here and there to fulfill their own selfish motives in the name of preaching and helping the whole world find welfare." Shri Puri Maharaj asked, "What makes you suspect they have not been sent by Shri Chaitanya Gaudiya Math?" Shri Raghunath Das replied, "When our respected Guru Maharaji, Shri Srimad Bhakti Dait Madhav Goswami Maharaj came to Amritsar, all the brahmacharis and sannyasis accompanying him never accepted anything for themselves, even after being requested many times. Instead, they always insisted they required nothing. But the devotees visiting my home today have deceitfully presented themselves as penniless and have presented a long list of demands. Their instructing tone smacks of self-righteousness and implies they feel themselves to be doing us a great favor by staying with us." Shri Bhakti Prasad Puri Maharaj then chastised the devotees and reminded them of their duty to follow Guru Maharaj's ideal conduct of being an Uttam Sevak, a topmost servant which is helpful in successfully spreading the teachings of Shri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Begging and building is to be done only for the pleasure of Shri Hari, Guru and Vaishnavas. When Guru Maharaj began performing Shri Navdeep Dham Parikrama from Shri Chaitanya Gaudiya Math, he was sometimes forced to seek out loans in order to fund its expenses. Yet, he would never ask for money from the devotees attending the Parikrama. When guest houses were constructed in Guru Maharaj's mutts in Sridham Mayapur, Sridham Vrindavan and other places, he never asked for any rent from the visiting guests. In order to manage the expenses of the mutt and to properly discharge other services such as preaching, he always gave more prominence to bhikshavritti, the practice of begging alms. His firm conviction was that the practice of nirguna bhikshavritti or begging alms for the pleasure of Sri Hari alone and not for one's sense gratification, prevalent in the Vaishnava Sampradaya is most favorable to bhakti, and that sattvic, rajasic and tamasic vrittis, activities motivated by the modes of goodness, passion and ignorance respectively, are unfavorable for bhajan. Guru Maharaj would say, in regard to those who undertake the responsibility of managing the affairs of a math, temple, sadhu nivas, residence for saintly persons, or guest house, our conception is this, kyo tare, kyo mare. Some may be delivered while others may be ruined. If these activities are performed without attachment to their results and are done in a way that is favorable to bhakti, then a person can cross the ocean of material existence. But if he engages in such services while being attached to their results, they become unfavorable for bhakti and will become further entangled in the web of material existence. When engaging in the services of organizing and managing the affairs of parikrama, accommodating Vaishnavas, building guest houses, awarding diksha and establishing deities, we should always remember that these activities should not be commercial. If any service is performed for the pleasure of anyone other than Sri Hari, Guru or the Vaishnavas, then it is Vaishya Vritti, an act of business. If someone constructs a place with a sole desire for Vaishnavas to come, stay and perform Kirtan and Harikatha, then this desire is the mother of all auspiciousness. As long as I was engaged in such services, I followed this order of Guru Maharaj to the best of my ability. The astonishing effect of Sadhu Sangha. During the installation ceremony of the deities at Sri Chaitanya Gaudiya Math in Mayapur, Sri Srimad Bhakti Rakshar Sridhar Gosai Maharaj with jhampas, footnote, large kartals or woompers, in his hands sang the following kirtan composed by Srila Narottam Das Thakur. Hari bolbo ar madan mohan heribo go, e roop brajer pathe chalibo go. Prathna 55.1. I will chant the names of Hari and behold Madan Mohan. In such a state, I shall travel the path to Braj. I never again received the opportunity to witness Srila Sridhar Goswami Maharaj performing Kirtan with the same transcendental and exceptionally unique mood in which he was so deeply absorbed that day. That was also the first occasion I saw Guru Maharaj raise his arms in ecstasy and loudly call out, Hari Bol. He did not ritualistically lift his arms every time after the kirtan, as is the custom nowadays. Once, when Guru Maharaj went to preach in Amritsar, a similar incident happened to me. When my godbrother, Sri Bhakti Lalit Giri Maharaj began singing, Guru Maharaj, Sri Srimad Bhakti Pramod Puri Goswami Maharaj, Shripad Krishna Keshav Prabhu, and others started dancing, I, too unknowingly started dancing with raised arms. Some days later, when my godbrother Sri Kharati Lal, a resident of Amritsar and principal of Guru Nanak University, informed me that I had danced profusely with my arms raised, I replied, impossible. I have never even danced in Kirtan, let alone danced with raised arms. When he said he could prove it with evidence, I challenged him. Let's see, how could you possibly prove this? He then brought a series of photographs that were taken that day, and I was greatly astonished to observe myself dancing in ecstasy with my arms raised high. The glory of the effect of associating with Guru Maharaj and other associates of Srila Prabhupada was such that my stone-like heart melted as a result of their mercy, and I unknowingly engaged in an act completely opposite to that of my natural behavior. Sri Harinam is the only solution. Once, when Guru Maharaj was preaching in Delhi, a man named Sri Hoti Lal Sharma, the husband of a greatly devoted god sister of ours from Meerut, Uttar Pradesh, came to meet him and said, Maharaj, although my father died long ago, I often see him in my home. He looks very sad. I consulted with many scholarly priests and diligently performed the many activities they recommended as possible solutions, including Narayan Bali and other rituals. But none of their methods proved fruitful. My wife has repeatedly asked me to approach you and request you to prescribe a solution. I would be extremely grateful if you were to suggest a solution by which the issue could be permanently resolved. Guru Maharaj advised him, daily perform kirtan of the Hare Krishna Mahamantra in your residence for 1 month. When Shri Hotilal Sharma asked Guru Maharaj, who will perform the kirtan? Guru Maharaj replied, you and your wife, and you should do so accompanied to the clapping of your hands. Meet with me after 1 month and let me know if the situation has changed. Guru Maharaj was still in Delhi when Shri Hotilal Sharma visited him again and said, my wife and I performed Mahamantra Kirtan as you advised, and after only 15 days, I stopped seeing my father. By your mercy, I have developed firm faith in the glories of the Harinam Mahamantra. Please accept me as your disciple. In this way, Guru Maharaj awarded him initiation into the chanting of the Harinam Mahamantra. It was because Guru Maharaj possessed firm conviction and unflinching faith in the glories of Sri Harinam that he recommended such a method and refrained from prescribing any lesser inferior solution. Expressing deeply subtle points through his language, whenever Guru Maharaj would construct a mat and install Shri Vigraha, he would always arrange for the deity of Sriman Mahaprabhu to be brought from Sri Navdeep Dham. His inner mood was that because Sriman Mahaprabhu appeared in Sri Navdeep Dham to distribute Unnat Ujjal Ras, the most exalted, resplendent mellow of transcendental amorous love to the whole world, his Vigraha should also come from Sri Navdeep. On one such occasion, Guru Maharaj asked Sri Bhakti Prasad Ashram Maharaj and Sri Chunni Lal Babu to bring Sriman Mahaprabhu's Vigraha from Sri Navdeep Dham, but they expressed their inability to do so. At that time, no plans had been made for me to attend the installation ceremony. Guru Maharaj sent a telegram wherein he ordered Sri Ashram Maharaj to send Narottam with Mahaprabhu. When I read the telegram, I very seriously began to contemplate why Guru Maharaj decided to arrange his words in this particular way. As a result, the following thought manifested in my heart. Guru Maharaj advised for the very form of Sriman Mahaprabhu present in his heart to be manifested externally as Sri Vigraha. In reality, Mahaprabhu's Vigraha is not inert, non-living matter, but is non-different from Mahaprabhu and is most worshipful. Therefore, Guru Maharaj is ordering me to come along with Mahaprabhu as his servant and not to bring his Vigraha along with me. In truth, no one possesses the ability to take Mahaprabhu anywhere. He is a supremely independent Lord. He goes anywhere he desires simply by that desire itself. Without his desire, no one can take him anywhere. The language Guru Maharaj used in his telegram was totally new to me. Never had such a thought previously come to me, even in a dream. Make Vaishnav Seva your very life and soul. Guru Maharaj often gave the following instructions to his renounced disciples. Renouncements should always remain careful to stay far away from the desire to attain kanak, gold or wealth, kamani, woman and pratishta, worldly prestige. You should assist everyone who comes forward with the desire to perform Bhagavad Bhajan, service to Bhagwan. The act of assisting those who wish to gain freedom from the clutches of Maya is among the limbs of bhakti. If for some reason a mathvasi becomes displeased and leaves the mat to return home, one should sincerely and honestly endeavor to bring him back to the mat. It is only when we fully accept the Vaishnavas to be worshipful or worthy of our sincere service, that we can become free from the clutches of Maya. There exists no other means. Without serving Vaishnavas, the inclination to serve Bhagwan will never arise in one's heart. Therefore, you should always sincerely endeavor to serve Vaishnavas and make such service your life and soul. The main reason for organizing festivals at the Math, such as Shri Braj Mandal Parikrama, Shri Navdeep Dham Parikrama, pilgrimage to North and South India, and so on, is to render service to and gain the association and blessings of the Vaishnavas. For serving them is the topmost sadhana. These teachings were perpetually reflected in the personal conduct, Hari Katha, and writings of Guru Maharaj. Three main obstacles on the path of bhajan. Guru Maharaj would often mention, Srila Prabhupada has said that there are three obstacles on the path of bhajan: kanak, wealth, kamani, woman, and pratishtha, prestige. Regarding the first obstacle, kanak, Srila Prabhupada taught that one can attain the topmost state of consciousness by avoiding deep attachment, asakti, to acquiring wealth, and instead cultivating deep attachment for the lotus feet of Sri Guru, Vaishnavas, and Bhagwan alone. It is improper for renunciants to worry about the future and accumulate material wealth. If those devotees who perform bhiksha, the collection of alms, for the service of Sri Hari, Guru, and Vaishnavas, do not hand over everything they have collected to the Math in charge, and instead keep something for their own personal use, they will not be able to perform Hari Bhakti. Such an act will never affect a shortage in the Math, but will rather only adversely affect one's spiritual advancement. While Srila Prabhupada was physically present, Sri Bhakti Sarang Goswami Maharaj, I, and Sri Bhakti Vilas Nemi Maharaj were, in that order, the foremost collector among all his disciples. Whenever I would stay with either Sri Bhakti Pradeep Tith Maharaj, Sri Bhakti Rakshar Shidhar Maharaj, Sri Bhakti Hidayvan Maharaj, Sri Bhakti Vichar Yajavar Maharaj, or other senior godbrothers, I would never spend a footy kauri, single farthing, from the collected money for my own personal use. I would, however, use some of the money to serve those godbrothers with whom I was staying by providing them with whatever they needed. The first thing I would do after collecting was hand over the entirety of the collections to the Math in charge, because I had heard from Srila Prabhupada that it is improper to use any donation one has received for one's own personal use. The proper method is to first hand over everything one has collected to the Math in charge, and then ask him for whatever one may need. Therefore, I would always ask Kunjda, footnote, Sri Kunj Bihari Vidyabhushan, who later became Sri Bhakti Vilas Tirth Maharaj, for whatever I needed. To ensure that the consciousness of those performing the service of bhiksha will gradually implement Srila Prabhupada's view on the etiquette of collecting donations, it is absolutely necessary for the Math in charge to be highly affectionate to all the Math's residents and, most importantly, always remain concerned for their spiritual advancement. Also, he must be realized in even the subtle matters of spiritual life, and he should be willing and able to take care of the residents of the Math when they are unwell or in other time of need, even if we must bear the burden of taking a loan to provide them with whatever they require. It is for this reason alone that I tell those who, being eager for me to construct a Math, wish to donate land to me, that I can only accept their land if I am able to find a suitable and virtuous devotee who can handle the responsibility of maintaining a Math, and whose association can effectively divert the consciousness of the local people toward the service of Sri Krishna. The reason we now have so many Mathvasis in our Sri Chaitanya Gaudiya Math is because from the very beginning I have taken care of all those who have taken shelter of the Math and have provided them with their day-to-day needs, accommodations, medicine, and treatment, even if it required taking on a loan. Sometimes it occurs to me, what would happen if I were to leave this world before repaying my debts? But Srila Prabhupada inspires me by reminding me from within that Sri Vishnu and the Vaishnavas are the only object of our service. If I am able to serve only one of the two, I will choose to serve the Vaishnavas. If I happen to leave the world before repaying a loan I had taken to serve the Vaishnavas, then I will repay that loan in my next life and will enthusiastically take on even more loans in order to remain in the eternal service of the Vaishnavas. My constant prayer is that I may maintain such a consciousness forever without deviating from this principle for even a moment. Srila Prabhupada mentioned Kamani as the second obstacle on the path of bhakti. For men, Kamani refers to women, and for women, it refers to men. Those who are unable to control their senses should be married by Vedic ritual. According to the Vedic scriptures, it is acceptable for even brahmacharis to enter householder life after performing upakurvana or begging their guru and senior Vaishnavas for permission by saying, I am unable to control my senses and I am unqualified to live a life of renunciation. I implore you to please allow me to enter into the grihastha ashram. But for those who have taken sannyas, it is strictly forbidden. A sannyasi who leaves the path of renunciation is a vantasi, or a person who eats his own vomit. Whether in a gross or subtle manner, it is most dreadful for renunciates to associate with women in a way that is against the injunctions of the Vedic scriptures. Those who sincerely desire to perform Hari Bhakti should always be mindful of the teachings given by our previous acharyas on this matter. Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur has said, Ramani jane sange sukham cha sakhe charame bhayadam purushartha haram shishi godrum chandra bhajan upadeshah 3. O friend, the pleasure to be had in the company of a woman leads to anxiety and robs one of the true goal of life. Sri Jagannath Pandit has mentioned in his Prem Vivarta 7.12, jadi chaho prane rakhite gauranga sane Chota Haridasir Katha Thako Jeno Mane. If you desire to maintain love for Sri Gauranga, then always remember the story of Chota Haridas. In Sri Chaitanya Chandandraya Natak 8.24, Sri Kavi Karnapur has quoted Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu as lamenting, Nishkinchinasya Bhagavad Bhajan Unmukhasya Param Param Jigamasor Bhavasagarasya Sadarshanam Vishayanam अथा योषितम च हंत हंत विश्व भक्षणंतो अभि असाधु. Alas, for those who have completely abandoned all material desires and seek to cross the ocean of nascence by sincerely cultivating service to Bhagwan, it is more detestable to expectantly see a sense enjoyer or enjoy gazing at a woman than to willing drink poison. Furthermore, it is written in Srimad Bhagavatam, Tamo Dwaram Yoshitam Sangi Sangam, Srimad Bhagavatam 5.5.2. The association of those who are fond of women leads to the deepest darkness. Srimad Mahaprabhu has been quoted by Srila Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami as follows. Prabhu kahe, Vairagi kare prakriti sambhashan, dekhite na paro ami tahar vadan. Sri Chaitanya Chaitamrita Antyalila 2.117. I will not see the face of a renunciate who interacts intimately with women. Khudra jeev sab markad vairagya kariya indriya charite bhule prakriti sambhashiya. Sri Chaitanya Chaitamrita Antyalila 2.120. Those immoral persons whose renunciation is like that of a monkey's simply wander around satisfying their senses and intimately conversing with women. We should repeatedly hear the explanation of these verses and many other verses like them from the lotus lips of Sri Guru and Vaishnavas and follow their lessons with a firmly determined heart. One can be saved from kamani only by associating with self-realized Vaishnavas. In this regard, Shri Narottam Das Thakur has written in Shri Prem Bhakti Chandrika 2.11, Kibava korite pare kam krodh sadakere jadi hai sadhu janer sanga. If one remains in the association of sadhus, then that association will take him beyond the influence of lust and anger, as well as the friends of these iniquities. Pratishtha, or worldly prestige, is the third and the most prominent obstacle on the path of Hari Bhakti. It is easy to recognize an attachment to Kanak and Kamani, but it is extremely hard to identify an obsession with Pratishtha. Unless a person is completely devoid of this desire himself, it is extremely difficult for him to recognize the true sadhu who is free from that same desire, and it is impossible for him to differentiate between those who long for Pratishtha and those who are completely free from any desire to attain it. In Shri Chaitanya Charitamrit Madhya Leela 4.146, Srila Kaviraj Goswami has mentioned, Pratishtha swabhav e jagate vidit jena vanche tar hai vidhata nirmit. It is common knowledge that the nature of prestige is such that by the arrangement of providence, those who do not want it, get it. A person who performs bhajan with a desire to attain pratishtha never in fact obtains that pratishtha. A Bengali maxim states, Je chahe se paye na, je paye se chahe na. One who desires something never obtains it, and one who obtains something never desires it. This is the barometer used to assess the desires present in the heart of a sadhak. Srila Prabhupada has likened the desire for pratishtha to be baghini or tigress. Just as a tigress swallows its prey whole, the desire for pratishtha, similarly, in the truest sense, swallows whole the sadhaka's mood of surrender, which is his spiritual life air. In other words, due to the effect of pratishtha, the sadhak begins leading an undisciplined life, devoid of principles and regulations. Therefore, if the sadhaka desires to achieve spiritual welfare, he should give up the desire for kanak, kamani, and pratishtha with firm determination and be cautious not to nourish them or allow them even the slightest opportunity to enter his heart. All such desires are temporary, are embodiments of inauspiciousness, and are completely against the natural propensity of a jiva, which is to serve Bhagwan. One should learn the difference between Falgu and Yukta Vairagya. Remember, all that glitters is not gold. Bhagwan is the maintainer of all. Guru Maharaj had a friend named Shri Haridas, who would often visit the rented apartment in which Guru Maharaj lived prior to joining the mutt. There, they would perform kirtan together. After staying in Kolkata for some time, Guru Maharaj joined the Gaudiya Mutt and went to preach in Madras, as per the instructions of Srila Prabhupada. After the Madras programs were completed, Guru Maharaj returned to Kolkata. Once, when Srila Prabhupada was scheduled to speak Harikatha at Darbhanga Hall of Kolkata University, Guru Maharaj requested Shri Haridas to accompany him to hear Srila Prabhupada speak. Shri Haridas replied, You have no one to cry after you. You are not married, and you have no children. But I have a wife and son, and I must maintain them. If I do not think about their maintenance, then who will? How will they receive a good life? Accompanying you to the program and hearing Harikatha will take time. If I were to instead spend that time earning money for my family, they would be better provided for. Guru Maharaj did not say anything to him at that time, but instead left on his own to go hear Srila Prabhupada's katha. A few years later, Guru Maharaj heard from his friend and godbrother, Sri Narayan Mukhopadhyay, that Sri Haridas had died in a car accident. One day, after Guru Maharaj had established Sri Chaitanya Gaudiya Math in Kolkata, Sri Haridas' son visited the mutt to have darshan of Guru Maharaj. After Guru Maharaj observed him offering pranam with great faith and devotion, he asked him who he was and from where he had come. He replied, "I am the son of your friend Haridas." Guru Maharaj then inquired about the well-being of his family, about his home and about his job, and gave him prasad before he left. After he left, Guru Maharaj narrated the above-mentioned incident with Sri Haridas to us and gave us a teaching. Haridas used to ask, "Who will maintain my family if not me?" But just see, his family has been maintained even after his death. The arrangements for one's maintenance, studies, and all other requirements are made by Bhagwan himself and not by anyone else. Prakriti kriyamanani gunai karmani sarvashah ahankar vimud atma kartaham iti manyate. Srimad Bhagavad Gita 3.27. All aspects of material activity are performed by the modes of material nature, but a person whose intelligence is bewildered by false ego thinks himself to be the doer. Do not become distracted from our only duty in this world. When Guru Maharaj was a brahmachari in the mutt, he met Dr. Sarvalli Radhakrishnan, who would later become the second president of India in 1962. Before Dr. Radhakrishnan became president, Guru Maharaj was once asked to represent the Gaudiya Math by chairing a debate between Dr. Radhakrishnan, a follower of the doctrine of monism, Advaitwad, and Dr. Nagaraj Sharma, a strong proponent of dualism, Dvaitwad. Feeling himself unqualified to accept the post and wanting to honor his senior godbrother, Guru Maharaj requested Sri Srimad Bhakti Rakshar Sridhar Goswami Maharaj to chair the debate. After he became President of India, Dr. Radhakrishnan invited Guru Maharaj to the presidential residence, Rashtrapati Bhavan. During that visit, Guru Maharaj took my godbrother, Sri Mangal Nilay Brahmachari, and me along with him to congratulate Dr. Radhakrishnan and gave him spiritual advice for leading the country. Dr. Radhakrishnan welcomed Guru Maharaj at the door and accompanied him inside the presidential palace. During the course of their conversation, Dr. Radhakrishna recited a verse about Vairagya. Later, Guru Maharaj offered him a flower garland that had earlier been offered to the deities, as well as some of the Thakurji's Mahaprasad. At that time, he quoted the same verse Dr. Radhakrishnan had previously quoted and explained the various types of Vairagya. Shushka Vairagya, dry renunciation. Markad Vairagya, monkey renunciation. Shamshan Vairagya, temporary renunciation. And Yukta Vairagya, practical renunciation. Guru Maharaj also explained the secondary meaning of the word Vairagya, which is Vigat Rag, or the absence of worldly attachments, and the principal meaning, which is Visheshta Param Purushe Rag, or a special attachment to the Supreme Person, Sri Bhagwan. Those who possess little intelligence appreciate the secondary meaning of the word, whereas the exalted devotees, Mahajans, always favor the primary meaning, which describes a natural detachment for worldly activities that manifests as a consequence of having developed deep attachment, anurag, to the Supreme Person, Sri Bhagwan. A person cannot become a devotee simply by controlling his senses in a superficial manner. If this were possible, there are many important people in this world who would have become great devotees. Superficial sense control has no meaning unless one possesses a deep affection and attachment to Guru, Sri Krishna, and Srimati Radharani. Indeed, renunciation without Krishna Priti is merely false renunciation. On the other hand, those who have a taste for serving the Lord are naturally renounced because they lose all interest in lower tastes as a result of experiencing that higher taste of Krishna Seva. Vishaya Pine Vartante Niharasya Dehinaha Rasavarjam Raso Apiyasya Param Drishtva Nivartate Srimad Bhagavad Gita 2.59. He who identifies himself with his body may restrict his enjoyment by withdrawing the senses from their objects, but his taste for sense pleasure remains. One whose intelligence is fixed, however, has realized Paramatma. Therefore, his taste for sense objects automatically ceases. Externally restraining the activities of the senses does not remove the desire to engage in those activities. Does fasting eradicate one's desire to eat? When a person experiences a high taste, however, his interest for lower taste very naturally disappears. The joy experienced in the service of Sri Krishna completely eclipses the charm found in the inferior pleasure of this world. It is for this reason Srimad Bhagavatam 7.1.32 states that Sri Narada Rishi instructed Maharaj Yudhishthir, Tasmat kenapi upayena manaha Krishna niveshayet. You should therefore fix your mind in Krishna by any means possible. The principle is the basis of Yukta Vairagya, which is truly the only worthwhile form of renunciation. When Dr. Radhakrishnan heard the enlightening words emanating from the lotus lips of Guru Maharaj, he offered Guru Maharaj pranam and expressed his sincere, heartfelt gratitude. During that occasion, many photographs were taken of Guru Maharaj with Dr. Radhakrishnan, and Sri Mangal Nilay Brahmachari and I were also included in number of them. Although due to my nature, I have not preserved those photographs, I am sure someone must have them. While we were exiting Rashtrapati Bhavan, Guru Maharaj told us, we did not come here as visiting guests or tourists who desire to explore an opulent building or admire architecture or beautiful objects. Our only objective in visiting any place is to chant the holy names of Bhagwan by performing kirtan and delivering harikatha. If any desire other than the desire to perform this service enters our heart, or if we develop an attachment to the wondrous objects of the world, we will never attain spiritual welfare. The only thought we should have while visiting any place or seeing any objects is that the whole world is a temporary embodiment of inauspiciousness. The one and only means of attaining our topmost welfare in this world is by remembering and chanting the names of Bhagwan, who is the eternal source of all auspiciousness. Maintaining our life here in a way that requires minimal efforts, we should spend all our time endeavoring to attain our principal objective, pleasing Sri Hari, Guru and Vaishnavas through love and affection. The importance of establishing Sambandha Gyan. At my Hiran Gate in Jalandhar, an old lady once asked Guru Maharaj, I have visited the temple daily since the time I was unmarried, and I have continued this practice even today in my old age, when I have been blessed with grandsons and granddaughters. There was never a time when I neglected this practice. However, even after reaching this advanced age, my mind does not for a moment remember Bhagwan, even if I try to force it to do so. Instead, it remains naturally and constantly absorbed in thinking about the well-being and happiness of my grandchildren. Please bless me by clarifying the reasons for the defective state of my mind and also prescribe the remedy so that I may meet with spiritual welfare. After attentively listening to the old lady's inquiry, Guru Maharaj replied, Your question is highly appropriate. Everyone should hear this question and its reply. I will therefore give my answer in the assembly tomorrow during Harikatha. The next day in the assembly, Guru Maharaj repeated the old lady's question and, for the spiritual welfare of everyone present, delivered his answer. Mataji, you have been daily visiting the temple for a long time, but have you once considered the nature of your relationship with the presiding deity of this temple? With a simple heart, the old lady replied, No, Maharaji, this thought never occurred to me. Guru Maharaj then said, It is impossible to develop love and affection for someone without first establishing one's relationship with that person. Only after realizing that mutual relationship can love and affection automatically manifest in the heart according to the nature of relationship. In the absence of a firmly established relationship, the mind can never become attached to Bhagwan by ritualistically visiting temples. Matirna Krishne Parataha Swatova Mithyo Abhivatted Grevratanam Adanta Gopir Vishutam Tamasrim Punaha Punas Charvita Charvanam Srimad Bhagavatam 7.5.30. Persons who are addicted to household life due to having uncontrolled senses are entering into hellish life wherein they repeatedly chew that which has already been chewed. Their consciousness cannot turn towards the service of Sri Krishna either by their own understanding, by the instruction of others, or by the combination of both. It is seen in this material world that love develops when service is rendered to one's beloved with care and affection. Without such affectionate service, a mother will not develop love for her own child, whether that child is naturally conceived or adopted, nor will a master develop love for his pet dog. Every jiva has an eternal servitor relationship with Bhagwan. When the conditioned jiva forgets this relationship and thus behaves in an opposition to it, the external potency of Bhagwan manifests this material creation and bestows worldly miseries upon him. The soul travels through the 8.4 hundred million species of life, assuming different bodies according to his past activities. Eventually, he attains this most rare human form by virtue of his previously accrued sukriti, spiritually pious activities. And by the endless mercy of Bhagwan, the jiva gains the direct association of an intimate and dear associate of the Lord. It is only through such association that he learns the eternal truth about who he truly is, who Bhagwan is, and the nature of their mutual relationship. Consequently, the inclination to serve Bhagwan arises in his heart. When he receives the seed of the creeper of bhakti, that is, the desire to serve Sri Krishna from Sri Gurudev, and plants that seed in his heart, he assumes the role of a gardener and provides the seed with water in the form of shravan and kirtan. As the bhakti creeper gradually grows, his love and affection for Bhagwan also increases proportionately. His affection and service to Bhagwan will only bear the fruit of Bhagavat Prem, transcendental love. After he firmly establishes his relationship with the Lord, if a person continues to simply visit a temple and return home after having darshan of the deity as per his own sweet will, pure love and affection for Bhagwan will never appear in his heart, even after thousands of lifetimes of this practice. Offer service before accepting anything. When Guru Maharaj would go out for preaching, he would always carry drinking water with him. After reaching the venue where he was to speak Harikatha, he would immediately perform kirtan and deliver his discourse. It was only after performing such services that he would accept water, prasad, or any offering from the organizers or hosts. If during the program he felt thirsty before he received the opportunity to perform the services of kirtan and harikatha, he would drink only the water he had brought with him, and not any water offered by the host. His view was, we are devotees. Our only wealth is Sri Hari, Guru and Vaishnavas. If we accept the offerings of our hosts without first offering to them this wealth through the means of harikatha and kirtan, then we will become indebted to them. Srila Prabhupada has taught us this important lesson through his own conduct. Once, when he was invited by the king of Kasim Bazar to speak Harikatha, but did not receive the opportunity to do so. For 3 days, he observed a total fast, accepting only one tulsi leaf. Similarly, in his Sri Upadeshamrita 4, Sri Rupa Goswami has explained the principle of Dadati Prati Ginnati. One ought first to offer before accepting, encouraging the propensity for sadhu seva. I once accompanied Guru Maharaj to Haridwar for Kumbh Mela. One morning, after I took bath in the Ganga and returned, Guru Maharaj came out of his room and told me, "I am going to take bath in the Ganga. Can you come along with me?" Without mentioning that I had just returned from bathing, I accompanied him as per his desire. Because all my clothes were soaking in a bucket at that time, I went shirtless, wearing only a dhoti. When we reached the ghat, one lady, regarding us as sadhus, offered me a new undershirt. I was not inclined to accept it, but Guru Maharaj said, "Accept the shirt. Whether or not you wear it is up to you, but accept it. Do not become an impediment to her inclination to render service." While we were returning to our pandal after taking bath in the Ganga, another lady approached me and offered halwa in a leaf cup. Because I was unwilling to accept something from a person not yet been initiated in our sampradaya, I refused to accept it. The lady said, "But this halwa is completely pure. With the intention of only serving it to Mahatmas, I cooked it in pure ghee I had made by my own hands from pure cow's milk." Guru Maharaj then told me to accept it, and I obliged. The lady offered a leaf cup of halwa to Guru Maharaj also, and he graciously accepted it. On our way back, my mind was busy reflecting. Sri Guru Maharaj himself has instructed us not to eat anything offered by non-Vaishnavas. However, today he himself ordered me to accept the offering of a non-Vaishnav. What is the reason for this? While my mind was occupied with such thoughts, Guru Maharaj understood my perplexity and said, "That lady was offering her halwa only to Mahatmas and not to anyone else. Whatever her internal desires may have been, her only intention, at least externally, was to serve the sadhus. It is our duty to nourish and encourage the propensity to serve sadhus and not to diminish it. Therefore, it is only appropriate to encourage her to serve sadhus by accepting her offerings. If you desire, you may give it to a faithful person who will be highly pleased to receive something from the hands of a sadhu." Understanding Guru Maharaj's message, I followed his instructions and began accepting the offerings of those who possess a sincere desire to serve sadhus. Dancing and singing for the pleasure of Bhagwan alone. Once, Guru Maharaj went to preach in Amritsar, where his Harikatha was arranged to take place in a temple situated in Namak Mandi. One day, after speaking Harikatha, Guru Maharaj took darshan of the temple's very beautiful Shri Shri Krishna Balaram deities, whose attractive forms acted as udipan or stimulus that awakened Krishna Prem in his heart. Absorbed in this Krishna Prem, Guru Maharaj became completely unaware of his surroundings and began ecstatically dancing and performing kirtan for a long time. Upon seeing Guru Maharaj's divine bodily features, which are found only on the bodies of Mahapurushas, great personalities, and gestural dancing, all the devotees and visitors were left spellbound. The next day, anticipating a repeat performance of Guru Maharaj's kirtan and dancing, the organizers arranged a special spot lighting and beautiful decorations to be placed before the deities, where Guru Maharaj had danced the previous day. When Guru Maharaj's Harikatha ended, that area was immediately cordoned off. The temple was overcrowded because those who were fortunate enough to have witnessed Guru Maharaj's kirtan the previous day had brought with them many other people. But on that day, When Guru Maharaj concluded his Harikatha, he left the temple immediately after reciting the Jaidhwani. A similar incident happened in Saharanpur as well. One day, Guru Maharaj performed an ecstatic kirtan and danced in complete bliss. The next day, the news spread everywhere of his heartwarming dancing and kirtan, and so everyone was eager to witness them. Many people assembled at the venue the next day. When Guru Maharaj was told that many people had come simply to witness his dancing and kirtan, and that they would feel blessed if he could begin the programs with that, he said, "Sadhus and Vaishnavs, do not engage in dancing and kirtan for the pleasure and entertainment of ordinary people. Rather, they do so purely with the intention of serving Bhagwan. If one performs kirtan to satisfy ordinary people, he may develop affection or attachment for them, but it can never be considered Hari Bhakti. Dancing or performing kirtan with a desire to acquire the recognition and praise of misguided individuals is in fact no better than the stool of hogs, and it is completely unfavorable for Hari Bhakti. In reality, such dancing and kirtan falls within the category of Treyartika, or the performance of materialistic dance, singing and playing of musical instruments. The whole world can be sacrificed for Ram Nam." Once Guru Maharaj preached in Guwahati, Assam, in the company of many other devotees, the most prominent of whom were Shripad Krishna Kesha Prabhu and Shripad Chintaharan Parthagiri Prabhu, both of whom were Assamese disciples of Srila Prabhupada, who knew the local language. As per the instruction of Guru Maharaj, the two met with Deshpriya Shri Gopinath Bordoloi, the then Chief Minister of Assam, who was an object of affection for the country's citizens, to invite him to hear Bhagavad Katha at Guru Maharaj program. During the meeting, Shri Bordoloi first asked them to introduce themselves, their organization, and the reason for their visit. After the introduction, he asked, "You are both Assamese. Why, then, have you not accepted the principles of Shri Bhagavad Dharma as preached in Assam by Shri Shankar Dev, Shri Damodar Dev, and others? Why have you instead accepted the teachings of Sriman Chaitanya Dev from Bengal?" Shripad Chintaharan Prabhu requested Shripad Krishna Kesha Prabhu to kindly answer Shri Bordoloi, and Shripad Krishna Kesha Prabhu obliged. "Respected Mr. Bordoloi, if I may, I would like to preface my reply to your question with a brief question of my own. You two are Assamese, and you belong to a Brahmin family. Why then did you consider it appropriate to attend Oxford University in England, accept Englishmen as your teachers, and follow their teachings when they use paper to clean themselves after passing stool, instead of following the proper practice of using water? What more should I speak about their lack of etiquette? Shri Navdeep Dham has long been famous as the Oxford of India, and scholars from even Assam have regularly visited Navdeep Dham for higher education. We therefore fail to understand the inherent fault in our following Shri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu." Shri Gopinath Bordoloi was rendered speechless. Shripad Krishna Kesha Prabhu and Shripad Chintaharan Parthagiri Prabhu left his office and returned to Guru Maharaj. When they arrived back at Guru Maharaj's quarters, they were greatly surprised to see that Shri Bordoloi sitting next to Guru Maharaj. They realized he had come by car while they traveled by rickshaw. At that time, kirtan was being performed in the hall. After kirtan, Guru Maharaj spoke Harikatha, which was followed by Mahamantra Kirtan. Later, while speaking with Guru Maharaj, Shri Bordoloi said, "Your method of preaching is very similar to that of Mahatma Gandhi. He performs Ram Dhun before and after lectures, and you perform Sankirtan before and after Harikatha." Guru Maharaj immediately replied, "When I read in the Congress mouthpiece Young India about Shri Mahatma Gandhi's statement, I can sacrifice even Ram Dhun for my country. I concluded that his conceptions were vertically opposed to that of the Gaudiya Vaishnavas, who firmly believes that even the whole world can be sacrificed for Ram Nam, what to speak of one country. Ram, being the absolute truth, is for himself and by himself, and every object is meant for his service. Even Western scholars accept that the absolute is for itself and by itself. Sri Gopinath Badaloi became highly inspired by the deep-rooted, subtle views of Guru Maharaj. After this incident, he often visited to hear Guru Maharaj Harikatha and honor Prasad with all of us. He also many times expressed his desire to abandon his active social life, accept sannyas, and stay always in the association of Guru Maharaj. His fellow Congress party members, however, would tell him, "If you accept sannyas, then our position in Assam will rapidly deteriorate." After a short time, Sri Gopinath Badaloi left this world. On inviting esteemed members of society, Guru Maharaj once sent me to invite Sri Gyani Jal Singh, the then Chief Minister of Punjab, who later became President of India, to be the chief guest for an annual function at the Chandigarh branch of Sri Chaitanya Gaudiya Math, scheduled for that very evening. I took my godbrother, Sri Dhananjay Das Adhikari, Sri Dharampal Shekhari, along with me, and went to Sri Gyani Jal Singh's office without having first made an appointment or even so much as having notified his office of our plans to visit. When we arrived, he was busy in an important meeting. His assistant told me, "Mahatma ji, I assure you that you will get to meet Mr. Singh, but I am afraid I cannot tell you how long it will take for his meeting to let out." "That is not an issue," I replied. "I can wait as long as it takes to meet him." After his meeting finished, Sri Gyani Jal Singh brought us to his room and accepted our invitation. At the end of our conversation, he said in Punjabi, "Sant ji, doodh chakko." "Your grace, please accept some milk," which Sri Dharampal Prabhu translated for me. After we accepted a glass of milk, I told Sri Gyani Jal Singh, "Let us now leave together for the function. Guru Maharaj and many other devotees are waiting in the mud." Sri Gyani Jal Singh readily said, "Chalo ji, chalo." "Sure, let's go." When we reached the mud, seeing us offering Dandvat Pranams to Thakur ji, Sri Gyani Jal Singh offered Dandvat Pranam and a pranami offering of 101 rupees. Guru Maharaj welcomed him and appointed him the chairman for that evening. In his speech as chairman, Sri Gyani Jal Singh said, "I considered myself very fortunate today. When I was invited, I thought I would be attending some sort of procession. But when I arrived at this assembly and heard the profoundly deep spiritual discourses spoken by the Mahatmas assembled here, I learned so many things." He told me after the program, "You have done me a great favor by bringing me here tonight." Later, I asked Guru Maharaj, "Whenever we hold festivals and functions at the various branches of Sri Chaitanya Gaudiya Math, you invite many distinguished persons, irrespective of whether they are Sikh, Arya Samaji, or followers of some other spiritual path. What is your internal reason for inviting them?" Guru Maharaj replied, "I invite the renowned members of the society and appoint them as chairpersons or chief guests in order to make them understand that the teachings of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu are relevant not only for Hindus but for the whole world. Because of their prominent positions in society, many other people will be inspired to sit in the assembly and hear these principles. By hearing the teachings of Srimad Mahaprabhu, all people, irrespective of race, caste, religion or country, will be benefited. The wise and intellectually inclined will certainly be influenced by and find merit in these teachings." Dr. Sarvapalli Radhakrishnan, the second president of independent India and a follower of non-dualism, Advaitwad, became attracted to Sriman Mahaprabhu's principle of inconceivable oneness and difference, Achintya Bheda Bhed Tattva, by only briefly associating with the sadhus of Sri Chaitanya Gaudiya Math. Being inspired by this association, he ceremonially inaugurated the Kolkata Research Institute of Sri Chaitanya Math and an oriental institute established by Sri Srimad Bhakti Hriday Van Maharaj. After Sri A.T. Ganguly, a renowned, well-educated and wealthy resident of Rajasthan, visited the Gaudiya Math twice and heard the logically expressed philosophical conclusion of the devotees here, he gave up the path of karma kanda, fruitative activities, and adopted the path of bhakti. Similarly, when a vice chancellor named Suraj Bhan Sharma, who followed the path of Arya Samaj, came to Sri Chaitanya Gaudiya Math and heard that in the practice of Sanatana Dharma, which gives great importance to the existence of consciousness and personalism, fire is considered a conscious demigod through whom offerings can be made to all other conscious demigods through the process of fire sacrifice, he too became attracted to the Gaudiya Math. All living entities can attain their supreme welfare by hearing about the true conception of the eternal relationship between the minutely conscious living beings and the supremely conscious Bhagwan. I invite distinguished guests for the sole purpose of making them hear these most exalted teachings. By offering them honor and respect, they become more inclined to hear our viewpoints. If they happen to be fortunate, they will accept Mahaprabhu's teachings. In this way, we follow Sriman Mahaprabhu's principle of Man Dena, or offering respects to one and all. If the objective of an invitation is righteous, then the invitation itself will always be righteous, no matter whom is invited. We do not invite prominent members of the society in order to exploit their positions for notoriety. Our sole objective is to help them and those related to them, attaining their true, topmost spiritual benefit. Through his pastime of refusing to meet with King Pratap Rudra, Sriman Mahaprabhu established, through his own conduct, that devotees should not meet with kings or politicians with the intention of personally benefiting from them. However, it is not prohibited to interact with kings or politicians in order to benefit them by engaging them in the service of Bhagwan. Sriman Mahaprabhu exhibited this when he later bestowed his transcendental mercy upon King Pratap Rudra for the king's spiritual benefit. The scriptures have mentioned, Nishkinchanasya Bhagavad Bhajan Unmakhasya Param Param Jigamaso Bhavasagarasya Sandarshanam Vishainam Atha Yoshitam Cha Ha Hanta Hanta Vish Bhakshanato Api Asadhu. Sri Chaitanya Chandradre Natak 8.24. Alas, for those who have completely abandoned all material desires and seek to cross the ocean of nascence by sincerely cultivating service to Bhagwan, it is more detestable to expectantly see a sense enjoyer or enjoy gazing at a woman than to willingly drink poison. Srila Madhavendra Puripad had taken a vow not to ask anyone for anything or meet with materialists, Vishais. But when Gopal specifically asked for Sakshat Seva, service performed either directly in person or by obeying a personal instruction, and not Aropit Seva, or service imposed on the Lord according to one's own desire, Srila Madhavendra Puripad met with many influential people in Puri and asked them to make contributions for the Lord's service. In this way, he broke his vows without incurring any fault. In the same way, we must remain careful to perform the Sakshat Seva ordered by Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Jare dekho tare kaho Krishna Upadesh. Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita Madhya Leela 7.128. Instruct whomever you meet to follow Sri Krishna's instruction. The Lord has further provided reassurance in this matter. Kabuna Badibe Tomar Vishay Tarang. Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita Madhya Leela 7.129. If you perform pure Sakshat Seva, you will not be enticed by materialistic people or materialistic objects. Following this instruction of Sriman Mahaprabhu is true Sakshat Seva, and we should never conclude that by obeying this order we are in any way disregarding the essence of the teaching Sriman Mahaprabhu has given by initially refusing to meet with King Pratap Rudra. On witnessing abominable behavior in sadhus. Once, Shivarda Prasad, the owner of a company that supplied electricity to Silchar, Assam, arranged for Guru Maharaj to deliver Harikatha at a program organized in a hall of his bungalow. During the program, a lawyer present in the audience wrote a question on a piece of paper and gave it to me with the request that I deliver it to Guru Maharaj. When I found an opportunity, I put the note on the table in front of Guru Maharaj. Shortly after Guru Maharaj read the note, he read the question aloud. The following verse is difficult to understand. Api che sudura charo bhajte mam ananya bhag sadur eva samantavyah sammak vyavasitu hi saha. Srimad Bhagavad Gita 9.30. Even if a man of abominable character engages in ananya bhajan, exclusive devotion to me, he is still to be considered a sadhu because his intelligence is firmly fixed in bhakti to me. How can a sadhu be engaged in abominable behavior? Sudurachar. After reading the question, Guru Maharaj turned off the fan near him, making sure that everyone witnessed him doing so. He then asked the same lawyer, why are the fan blades still rotating even though the power has been turned off? Because of their previous momentum, the lawyer replied, but it will gradually slow down and finally stop. Guru Maharaj then explained, in the same way, a person who has taken up the path of one-pointed bhakti completely abandons all sorts of sudurachar. But due to his past impressions and previous habits, some of those undesirable actions may still be visible in his character for some time. Even so, he must be considered a sadhu because the very next verse states, Shipram bhavati dharmatma shashva chantim nigachati kaunteya pratijanihi name bhaktah pranashyati. Srimad Bhagavad Gita 9.31. He quickly becomes virtuous and attains eternal peace. O Kaunteya, declare it boldly that my bhakta never perishes. In other words, if he is one-pointed to Krishna, he will very quickly become dharmatma or a pure devotee, even though he is seen to engage in sudurachar due to his previous habits. Obtaining the true benefit of performing parikrama. Guru Maharaj used to explain that in his Prem Bhakti Chandrika 2.5, Srila Narottam Das Thakur has written, Tirtha Jatra Parishram Keval Maner Bhram. The labor of visiting places of pilgrimage is nothing but the mind's bewilderment. In other words, it is purely illusion to think that one attains spiritual merit by visiting places of pilgrimage. Hearing this statement, one may be inclined to conclude that performing dham parikrama serves no purpose. But in Srimad Bhagavatam 9.4.20, while glorifying Maharaj Amrish and describing how he engages all of his senses in the service of Bhagwan, Sri Shukdev Goswami has said, Padau Hare Shetra Padanu Sarpane. He engaged both his legs in walking to the places where Sri Hari had performed his pastimes. How can we reconcile these seemingly different perspectives about performing parikrama? Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur has revealed the actual meaning of Srila Narottam Das Thakur's aforementioned statement, and in doing so, has verified its harmony with the above verse from Srimad Bhagavatam. Gaur Amar Je Sabasthane Karolo Brahmana Range से सब स्थान हेरिबो आमी प्रणय भकत संगे। शरणागति 6.3.3। इन द कंपनी ऑफ प्रणय भक्तस आई विल विजिट एंड बिहोल्ड ऑल द प्लेसेस वेयर माई गॉड जॉयफुली विजिटेड। द ट्रू एम ऑफ परफॉर्मिंग परिक्रमा इज टू अटेन प्रोग्रेस इन भक्ति एंड टू डेवलप लव एंड अटैचमेंट फॉर द प्लेसेस वेयर भगवान परफॉर्म्ड हिज पास्ट टाइम्स। दिस अटैचमेंट इज ट्रांसमिटेड फ्रॉम द हार्ट्स ऑफ प्रणयी भक्तस। डिवोटीज हु पोजेसेस अ डीप ट्रांसडेंटल लव फॉर द लॉर्ड इन टू द हार्ट्स ऑफ दोज हु एक्सेप्ट शेल्टर एट द लोटस फीट। इट इज ओनली व्हेन परिक्रमा इज परफॉर्म्ड इन द एसोसिएशन एंड अंडर द गाइडेंस ऑफ सच प्योर डिवोटीज दैट इट यील्ड्स द हाइएस्ट बेनिफिट। द फायर ऑफ सेपरेशन touches those nearby. Once during Brajmandal Parikrama in 1956, Guru Maharaj was singing a Bengali kirtan in front of Sri Adi Keshav Dev. Ohe Brajavasi, Tora Bole Dao, Kotha Gele Krishna Babu. O Brajavasis, please tell me where I should go in order to meet with Krishna. Because the majority of the devotees present during that kirtan were from North India, they were unable to understand the meaning of the Bengali kirtan. Still, tears flowed from the eyes of everyone who heard Guru Maharaj's heart-melting voice. I had never previously danced in kirtan, but the power of that particular kirtan was such that my feet started moving and I began dancing without any intention or even the slightest desire to do so. It was as if something was forcing me to dance. After Guru Maharaj Kirtan, one Mataji from Jagadri, Punjab, named Mitrani, approached Sri Srimad Bhakti Vikas Rishikesh Goswami Maharaj, a disciple of Srila Prabhupada, and asked, "Could you please explain the meaning of the Kirtan Guru Maharaj was singing just now?" After Srila Rishikesh Goswami Maharaj explained the meaning, she said, "The transcendental bliss we experienced during that kirtan was indescribable. But even after hearing its meaning, the same type of bliss is not manifesting in my heart. Why is this so?" At that time, I asked her, "Mataji, if you do not know the meaning of the kirtan, then why were you crying upon hearing it?" She replied, "Actually, I do not know. Upon hearing the kirtan, tears flowed automatically. It was natural and spontaneous. Out of deep love, the pranayi bhaktas suffer feelings of viraha, separation from Sri Krishna, when they feel themselves unable to attain His direct darshan. If we sincerely perform parikrama in the association and under the guidance of such devotees, then the viraha agni, fire of separation present in their hearts, will certainly touch us also. However, those who perform parikrama with devotees who lack such transcendental love for the Lord can never experience these transcendental pangs of separation. When a mother loses her young child, the pain and anguish present in her heart can be felt very empathetically by everyone around her. Upon seeing tears pour incessantly from her eyes, others become touched by her grief and begin to cry also. But if an unmarried woman with no children finds anguish and shouts, 'My child has died,' then although she may weep bitterly, her fraudulent expressions will have no impact on those who know her and will have a short-lived effect on those who do not know her. Similarly, the true fruits of performing parikrama, deep love and attachment to Sri Hari and His pastime places, can never be obtained in the association of ordinary devotees. It may be possible, though rare, that one may experience feelings that resemble separation in the association of ordinary devotees. But such sentiments are only fleeting. They are neither transcendental nor eternal. While watching a film, one may for a moment imbibe the emotions expressed by the film's actors, but those emotions will fade shortly after the story's end. In the same way, The sentiments experienced by a person when he performs parikrama in the association of devotees who do not possess pranaya, affectionate love for the Lord and his pastime places, quickly fade. In such sangha, one can only attain punya or the cleansing of his past sins, but never bhakti unmukhi sukriti, spiritual fortune that leads one to the path of bhakti. What to speak of pranaya, which is a real fruit of the dham parikrama and is obtained only in the association of pranayi bhaktas.